And I admit I'm an under-prepper. You know, I often tell the story of how I belong to a 12-step group called Under Preppers Anonymous. We meet every Thursday morning at a local church and share coffee and donuts and talk about our struggle and any slips we've had in under-reducing that week. We've had 30 years of a pretty good thing in dentistry, and I think it's time that we have to step up to the plate and kind of do our job. And I think this picture on the screen kind of illustrates this. This is a screenshot of a dental technician here at the laboratory measuring the reduction that's been done for an Emax crown on a molar and sent in by a dentist. And you can see that the laboratory technician can simply click on the prep tooth and the opposing tooth. And when they click on these two spots, it tells them that there's 0.85 millimeters of reduction. Now, as you'll see in a minute, we need a minimum of 1 millimeter of reduction for Emax lithium disilicate on a molar, and preferably more. So with this minimum of 1 millimeter, the lab now has to call the dentist and say, hey, we don't have enough reduction on this tooth for an Emax restoration. Now, for the last 30 or 40 years, it was kind of a he said, she said, where the lab technician would say, hey, I don't think you reduced enough on this tooth. And you'd be all, well, I was there and I'm pretty sure I reduced enough. And since we write checks and give them to the technicians, the argument would kind of end there. They wouldn't give us too much pushback. But for the first time ever, for the last 5 years or so, dental laboratories have jumped ahead of dentists in terms of technology. And there's way more technology now in the average dental laboratory than there is in the average dental practice. And as a result, because of the embrace of CAD/CAM by laboratories, it's very easy for them, whether we send a digital impression or a traditional polyvinyl or polyether impression, for them to pour up the stone models, scan it, and then do exactly what you see here, which is click in between our prep and our opposing tooth and see to the hundredth of a millimeter how much we reduced. There's no more he said, she said. We've been caught red-handed under reducing. Now, when you look at the crowns that come in here to the lab at Glidewell, you'll notice that 75% of the crowns are single unit crowns and another 11% are two unit crowns. So we're the largest lab in the country, and dentists from all 50 states are sending cases in here. And out of those cases that are coming in, 86% of them are one and two unit crowns. So I would say, with the way insurance reimbursement is, three crowns together, you know, 18, 19, 20, or wherever they may be, or 7 through 10, those four, that's kind of the sweet spot for crown and bridge, where we can be our most productive, have the least amount of remakes. So the good news is, it would appear the dentists of America, for the most part, or at least the ones using Glidewell, are doing it one and two units at a time. And if we can get really efficient at these and really good at turning out good one and two unit cases, we're gonna have a pretty good career in dentistry. And so one of the ways to get proficient is with Loupes, and we did not have these in dental school. This was an after dental school modification. These are the three Loupes in one. It's a 3X, 4X, and 5X. The downside of these is they're kind of heavy. You know, if you don't have a wide, broad nose like I do, an Italian nose that can support a lot of weight, you may not like these Loupes. But I love prepping everything at 3X. I went from 2X with my first set and then to 2.5 on my next set of Loupes. Now I'm at 3X for most of the prep, but I love going to 5X for the last 90 seconds to 2 minutes of the preparation. So we need to make absolutely sure how smooth the margin is. It doesn't matter with the rest of the tooth, leave it rough. It's micromechanical retention, it's fine. But when laboratory technicians got involved with CAD/CAM and started blowing up dentist margins, you could see the chunks out of the margin, and it makes it very hard for them to mark the margin. It ends up looking like a Richter scale with a 2.0 earthquake kind of going along the margin, and most materials don't like to be in that kind of zipper shape. And so we need to smooth it, because we know when the technicians blow up, they're going to see it. So these are the Loupes that I like. So for this case, we're going to prep tooth number 9 using this technique. It's an interesting case, because tooth number 7 is an all ceramic crown, not a very good one. Tooth number 8 is a natural tooth, and 10 and 11 are splinted PFM. So we've got all kinds of things going on here. And tooth number 9 is an endodontically treated tooth with some old failing composites in approximately. So we're gonna go ahead and prep this for a crown. So step 1 of the reverse preparation technique, like most other crown prep techniques, is the break to contacts. So again, I'm just gonna use a 56 burr here. All we're trying to do is create some space between the prep tooth and the adjacent tooth. So here we are putting in a double zero cord. This is an UltraPack cord from UltraNet, and I'm just flossing it into place like it was dental floss, and then leaving a little excess on the facial so I can pack that down into that facial sulcus. Now this cord hasn't been soaked in anything. There's no epinephrine or anything in any of the strands. So it's a totally plain cord. So here we go. I said we were gonna be doing it early, and very early on we're prepping. And then we put the copper cap on top, have the patient bite down for 10 minutes. I come, and why 10 minutes? Because that's how long it takes me to do a hygiene exam. But no, 10 minutes in this case is to get all the blood out of there. Take it off, rinse off whatever styptic material you're using. It will look like the patient had a gingival transplant. I mean, the gingiva looks so good, it will blow you away. Don't admire it too long because the blood's coming back from the capillary bed and it's angry that it's been forced out for the last 5 minutes. So take it off and quickly take that impression. But these anatomical copper caps can be lifesavers in dubious crown and bridge situations, especially on posterior teeth, anteriors too, but especially on posterior teeth. So the reverse preparation technique works fantastic anytime that you're prepping a crown for the first time on a tooth. But what about all those times where we're taking off an old crown and we don't know where we are? For years, I struggled with that and what to do. And that was solved for me a couple years ago when a company called Contact Easy came out with the PrepSure crown prep guides that you see on the screen right now. So reduction is very important, and considering that every lab owner and technician I've ever talked to says it's the number one issue that they fight with us dentists, we need to step our game up. It's time. For 30 or 40 years, we got away with eyeballing it and under prepping and hoping they didn't notice or just arguing that with them, but they're checking it now digitally. Every lab is. The gig's up, they can see what's going on. We gotta step up. So whether it's getting involved with, you know, digital scanning so we can check our reduction that way, using the reverse preparation technique or using those PrepSure guides from Contact Easy, make sure you're reducing and checking enough. I really hope you'll get some of those round burrs and try doing the margin that way. It's a fantastic way to be able to form that margin and get some depth cutters for your initial prep so you know where you are. I promise you, the more attention that you pay to reduction and getting the right reduction in the right places, the better the restorations will look that come back from your technicians, and the more your technicians will love working with you.
Are you enjoying this instructional video? I hope so. If you'd like to receive additional clinical instruction with AGD and ADA approved CE credits, all at no charge, be sure to visit glidewelldental.com/education, where in addition to over 60 on-demand clinical courses, you can also access our weekly webinars along with other valuable content.
With the rise of the monolithic restorations like solid zirconia and lithium disilicate, I don't find much of a use for my 2mm depth guard anymore. I'm using the 0.6, the 1, and the 1.5 most of the time. Those are the workhorses, and the 2, and not so much even the 0.6. The 1 and the 1.5 get the most use. The 2mm, I'm not using that much because I don't do bilayered restorations anymore, like porcelain fused to metal, porcelain fused to zirconia.